Morning and welcome to City Center Community Committee for April 25th. With me is Councillor Gilroy and Kate McMillan and a variety of public servants and a variety of delegations. But before we begin the meeting, I'd like to state with my gravelly voice affected by allergies, my apologies, that we this meeting is taking place on beautiful Treaty One land, the homeland of the Red River Métis, where we get our water from Shoal Lake 40 and Dakota Territory. If Councillor Gilroy could move the minutes of the previous meeting.
So moved.
All those in, that was carried unanimously because there's just two of us today. So a lot of the votes might go like this. I'll turn it over to the clerk for delegations.
Can we go back some for Councillor Orlicott?
So moved.
That was carried unanimously.
Okay. And then we have six delegations, one of which is to appear on one of the addendum items. So if we can get a suspension of the rules to consider the two new business items on the agenda, items number 23 and 24.
So moved.
That was carried unanimously.
Great. The first delegation today is Kyle Mitchell to be heard with respect to report number 21. And Kyle is joining us via Zoom. Kyle, if you want to go ahead and unmute yourself and turn on your video, you have up to 10 minutes for your presentation.
Okay, hello, thank you. My name is Kyle Mitrick. I live in the St. James Ward, but I live right on the border with Daniel Mack, so I think of myself more of a city center resident.
Kyle,
I'm here to get you to consider adding.
It's a bit quiet in the chamber. If you could just kind of make sure you're speaking into your microphone. Sorry.
It's very hard to hear you. I'm sorry. If you could speak a little louder.
Okay, I'll just turn up my mic. Just one sec.
Okay.
All right, one sec. Okay, well, I hope that's a little bit better. I'll try. I don't really want to yell in my house, but I guess I'll yell in my house.
That's 100% better.
Okay, so I live in the St. James Ward, but it's right on the border with Daniel Mack, so I think of myself more as a city center resident. I'm here to get you to consider adding something to the action plan. And then I'll talk about something else if I have time. So one of the best ways to create a green and growing city is to get rid of parking minimums. Parking minimums create arbitrarily large parking lots that take up valuable space that could be used to create more density. And currently the parking lots sit mostly empty. A study in Edmonton found that for commercial properties, the maximum usage was about 39%. And even for residential, it was about 64%. This means parking lots could be reduced by about two-thirds for commercial and one-third for residential without any issue. Edmonton removed parking minimums in 2020, and I recommend that you look at the studies that supported it, including the comprehensive parking study that I'm quoting from. They found Edmonton had an oversupply of off-street parking, which if Winnipeg studied it, you'd probably find the same results. Obviously, some parking is necessary, but it should be decided on a case-by-case basis, and the city should be prioritizing density and discouraging people from using cars while encouraging them to walk, cycle, and use transit instead, especially if the property is along a major transit route. Encouraging residents to use transit would help move towards a green city. For example, I noticed the apartments that are being built by the transitway have large parking lots. That defeats the purpose of them being built by frequent transit. We should be encouraging those people to use the transit nearby by having very minimal parking facilities. So because we need to move away from a car-centric city, and getting rid of parking minimums is a major start to that. On a completely financial basis, the more dense a property is, the more in property taxes the city gets, as parking lots don't generate as much for a city as a building does. I could show my math on this, but I won't because it's a little boring, but I'll just give you the property taxes per acre. So like, for example, Sargent businesses on the north side between Elverston and Arlington generate about $54,000 per acre for the city. Sherbrooke businesses on the east side between Wolseley and Westminster generate $36,000 per acre. But if you look at something like Royal Sports on Pembina, which is mostly a parking lot, it only generates $10,000 per acre. for the city. And if you look at some big properties like Walmart on Empress and Sargent, it generates about 18,000 per acre for the city. And Grant Park Mall, for example, generates 24,000 per acre. Because large commercial spaces have parking minimums that force them to have very large parking lots, which we've seen as the in the report in Edmonton could be one third the size and still function sufficiently. This lack of density is shown in how much per acre is less than the dense spaces. And if we look at Royal Sports, because of parking minimums, it forces them to have an arbitrarily large parking lot. And this completely drops the per acre property taxes to a really low level. And if we look at some proposed projects that are coming up, a few I checked out, like DASZ30-2020, which Councillor Rollins might be aware of, is a project on Marion. Because of parking minimums, the project basically turns out to be mostly parking lots. Without parking minimums, parking would still be there, but it would be what was needed for the project, instead of hitting some sort of arbitrary ratio. And in apartments being built, which have a ratio of 1.5 spots per unit, it forces arbitrarily large parking lots again. For example, one project I looked at, they had 169 units, so the parking lot that was had to be built was 254 spots, meaning that the parking lot, again, takes up way more space than the actual housing. Without this arbitrary ratio, the housing, which is desperately needed in Winnipeg, could be densified, and more commercial properties could be added to the Marion project, which increases the amount of property taxes going to the city, which builds more dense housing and encourages people to find other means to go to commercial properties, which is all positives. So I hope the City Center Committee will consider removing parking minimums to the action plan. We cannot truly move towards a green city until we move away from being car-centric. We can't do that until we reconsider how we are building our city, not forcing large, unnecessary parking lots to be built, and instead going on a case-by-case basis as a start to achieve this. Ecologically and financially, it makes sense. So the other comment I'll make with my last 5 minutes is just on being opposed to the expansion of Kempston. Other people will probably speak to this, but it's probably one of the most pointless projects Winnipeg could go forward with. It defies logic as to why it's on the action plan document. It goes against making the city a green city by promoting vehicle traffic. And the reason it's pointless is because it doesn't meet any of its stated goals. If you wanted to move people more efficiently, then expanding vehicle lanes is the least efficient way of doing it. Transit by far moves more people efficiently. That's basic math, though. Buses hold more people. So if you want to move more people efficiently down Kempston, changing one of the current driving lanes into a bus-only lane would do the trick. With the current frequencies, transit would move more people than expanding Kempston by one lane would. And the other goal is moving cargo faster. Well, the biggest impediment to that currently is non-commercial vehicles. So if you reduce the amount of vehicles, of those vehicles driving on Kempston, then the cargo moves faster. The best way to do that isn't by expanding lanes, which would potentially bring in more vehicle traffic. It's by improving transit. So both of the stated goals of expanding Kempston could be done by improving transit, and the cost would be much, much smaller than what is going to cost to expand Kempston. So I hope this City Center Committee will remove that expansion from the action plan. So I thank you very much for your time.
Thank you very much. I have a question. I don't know if you have a question. So when on your first request, you want to see parking minimums be prioritized within the SPAP.
The removal of parking minimums.
Okay. So I just, are you aware that there's been no shortage, I think, of two motions this term to just do just that already underway that predates the work on the Strategic Priorities Action Plan? The latest one that I did myself was around the Affordable Housing Now program.
Yeah, but I'm saying that's specific. I know in downtown they don't have parking minimums, but as a whole, the city should just get rid of it.
Okay, I think we're saying the same thing. All right, prioritizing it within the elimination within the SPAP. Thanks for your time today. I appreciate you coming down and talk about the city's action plan.
Yeah, thank you.
Our next allegation is a non-argument, also to be heard via Zoom. Now, if you want to go ahead and unmute yourself and show up to make sure your presentation.
Great. Hello, everyone. Can you hear me?
Yep. Yes, we can. Go ahead. Nice to see you.
Awesome. Good to see you too. Thank you so much for having me here today to talk about this very critical item as we move into the four-year budget. At Green Action Center, our vision is all Manitobans living green, living well, and we pursue that vision through our sustainable transportation systems in the program that I work with. And I'm here today on behalf of Green Action Center, the Transportation and Land Use Coalition, and then myself as a resident. I live in South Osborne. So at Green Action Center, we're actively involved in the creation of strategies and master plans with the city. For example, our Winnipeg Complete Communities, infill strategies, transit master plan, you name it, we help out there. Some of these have been approved, others are in the works, and we're very grateful to be part of these strategies and plans. We take our participation very seriously, providing many hours to prepare, review, submit comments, and monitor results. And because of our commitment to these plans and strategies, we're excited to see many of the actions that are in the SPAP. At the same time, we see two action items that we staunchly oppose as they just contradict all of the other items outlined below. So some of the awesome things that we really love from the appendix, converting surface parking lots into green space and points of connection in number one, amending zoning bylaws, number 14, the creation of a safety plan coordinated at the community level with partner agencies, 20. We're thrilled to see the acceleration of the transit master plan, number 28, addressing road safety through street design. Number 33, all of these just fit so well into the approved plans and strategies and will serve Winnipeggers well in the present and in the future. To that end, we want to state that we oppose strategies 17 and 18, the extension of the Chief Peguis Trail and the widening of Keniston. Neither of these projects align with the goals and strategies approved. In fact, they are in direct opposition to plans like the Climate Action Plan. The stated desires for the outcomes of Keniston and the Chief Peguis Trail is to increase trade, goods, and people movement. Widening Keniston and extending Chief Peguis Trail will not only not have the desired outcomes stated, but even worse, they'll inhibit the desired outcomes of many other action items. These projects are currently estimated to cost $1 billion. No doubt, were they ever to move forward, their costs would be much higher due to inflation and rising construction costs. In fact, King Claussen, in his EPC presentation in March of 2023, noted that they were estimated to cost between $2.4 and $2.7 billion with financing and maintenance cost, and that's based on the City of Winnipeg unfunded major projects detail. So the question is, are they going to be worth the price? For trade corridors, trucking companies have moved their routes from Keniston to Centerport. Winnipeg has heavily invested in Centerport, and this is the desired route for trucking companies. Keniston is no longer of interest. And also, when examining the traffic on this route, only 4% of current traffic is trucks. The vast majority of vehicles on this road are personal vehicles, most of them single occupancy. And while trucking isn't an important part of the economy, will multi-billion dollars of investment for this infrastructure result in enough revenue to justify not only the expense, but also cover the costs of maintenance and replacement? And not only that, we're told that these projects will go above and beyond, providing dividends. And this is stated in the recent advertorial from the Manitoba Heavy Construction Association to cover the costs of housing programs, trees, and other programs. But we can see that the results in Winnipeg's past investment in road infrastructure, and it's clear that these investments are not productive growth. People movement. While Chief Peguis Trail extension will include some bike infrastructure, no doubt Keniston will as well, it will in no way counter the induced demand for personal vehicle travel that these two projects will create. The increased congestion will negate any benefit offered by any AT infrastructure. The increased congestion will further slow the movement of goods. In fact, in the last federal funding application that the city made, it showed that the widening of Keniston is expected to increase travel times from 9.6 minutes in 2017 to 20 minutes by 2041. The environment. We've heard it argued by the Winnipeg Chamber and others that travel lanes will reduce idling, making it better for the environment. These claims, they're simply not true. As Joe Courtwright noted in his article, Urban Myth Busting, Congestion, Idling, and Carbon Emissions, and I quote, adding more capacity might reduce idling a bit, but it will actually induce more driving, which will lead to higher, not lower carbon emissions. That's from City Commentary. Fix it first. We've heard Councillor Luke say that we're over our heads with the roads that we have. We can see our inability to care for what we have in the plethora of potholes every year. We examined this problem with the Transportation and Land Use Coalition at theanatomyofapothole.ca. When you find yourself in a hole, stop digging. Car-oriented sprawl. We're really concerned that the extension of Chief Peguis Trail will lead to more car-oriented development in the area. We've heard it. Councillor Sharma say that many new subdivisions in her ward have no access to Winnipeg Transit already, which results in an overwhelming number of personal vehicles, causing problems further downstream. As she noted, the increased congestion on roads in her ward. During that same budget meeting this year, we heard from Councillor May speaking about the downstream congestion problems on routes like St. Mary's Avenue due to the expansions to the south of developments that primarily rely on residents to travel by personal vehicles. And we know that the Chief Peguis Trail extension, the resulting development will be car-oriented and contribute to further problems downstream. We also know that car-oriented sprawl is very expensive and it does not generate enough revenue to cover those costs. Again, we just think that we need to stop digging ourselves into more problems. And on this point, I'd really like to speak as a resident, a longtime resident of Central Winnipeg. We're always downstream. Our residential neighbors suffer from the increase in traffic, the cut-through traffic, the safety concerns that come with that. We had one of the deaths this past year along Osborne. I found the city's first bike map, and the recommended route in our neighborhood is, at that time in the 90s, was a low-stress route was to go up Osborne and enjoy all the shops and head into Osborne Village to enjoy the destinations there. I have been cycling for a decade now, and I would never travel up Osborne. We've just completely lost those connections in our neighborhood. And as you noted in your comments during the budget meetings, Councillor Gilroy, we also face the downstream effects of having our services suffer due to this unproductive growth. You're right. We don't need those flashy capital projects. We need operational funding. These projects, once again, promise us trickle-down economics, that our needs will be met if only we invest in these projects because they will generate the revenue. That just doesn't happen. And year over year, when it comes to the cost of maintaining all of this infrastructure, we are facing those tough choices at budget time. So we do agree, though, on the desired outcomes in the Strategic Action Priorities Plan. And we have some suggestions of how you can get to those desired outcomes. Movement of people. We recommend spending these funds on implementing the Transit Master Plan and pedestrian cycling strategies. Winnipeg needs to reduce its drive-alone mode share from 80% to 50% by 2030. Moving people on foot, bike, and bus is much more affordable, efficient, and sustainable than personal vehicles. Moving people via these modes has a much higher ROI than personal vehicles. For example, and I linked a study for you in my submission from the US, it found that the ROI was 10 times higher than personal vehicles. More people moving, more money for the city. That's a win-win. Movement of goods. These routes are currently only serving 4% of traffic as trucks, and those trucks are primarily moving goods from within the city of Winnipeg, as opposed to trade, which are using the perimeter highway and center port. So is such a large investment here going to have the desired effect? If trucks are indeed being slowed by the congestion of personal vehicles, we believe the best results, not only along these routes, but throughout the city, will happen if we can reduce the number of personal vehicles on the road. Again, personal vehicles are an extremely inefficient way of moving people. An investment in transit would have a more profound impact on the flow of goods everywhere. A strong economy. The Climate Energy Investment Report, the SEER report, lays out many opportunities for Winnipeg to grow our economy and create jobs. The energy transition is the opportunity of a lifetime for our generation and the generations to come. Instead of spending millions of dollars and years pursuing Chief Peguis and Keniston, why not dedicate those funds and that time to the strategies laid out in this roadmap? Why not even just get a report on spending $1 billion on strategies in here just to compare at budget time and just see, you know, what else we can get if we spent that money elsewhere?
Mel, you're at time. Did you need great. A few minutes to wrap up or?
Yeah, just wrapping up. Okay. Yeah. So yeah, in conclusion, we just want to recommend that you remove these projects from the action plan. We can't afford it. The projects will cost so much to continue to plan and develop and take up valuable opportunities to partner with other levels of government, and other action items that do align in the approved plans and strategies will just not receive the proper support. And just looking forward, we really want to see the city adopting informed community engagement with the community for future strategic action plans. We found the turnaround time between finding out about this report and being able to get submission in and check back to the plans and seeing what was aligned and what was aligned and what wasn't and what we should do. The only reason I know about it is because Mark Coho forwarded an email to the Transportation and Land Use Coalition. And the only reason I'm here today is because my boyfriend had COVID last week. So I had to cancel a bunch of meetings that I had. So I had time to just register for the meetings and to complete a submission. Otherwise, I wouldn't be here today. There was just absolutely no time. It's such a busy time of year in sustainable transportation.
I hope you have, you're well at home. That's your time, unless Councillor Gilroy, you need an extension, Ms. Marginet?
No, we just really look forward to more informed community engagement in future plans, just so it's not such a surprise.
Okay. So are there any questions? Green Action Center, are you representing Green Action Center today?
Green Action Center, myself as a resident, Transportation and Land Use Coalition.
Have you talked to Treaty One with respect to your position on Route 90? I understand your points with respect to Chief Peguis, but have you talked to Treaty One with respect to, you know, as Green Action Center, with respect to Route 90?
I just heard about that this in the strategic action plan on Thursday. No, but I do know from the development that's going to happen along Keniston there that widening Keniston would the consultant deem that it would be devastating to have a freeway run along that development.
Okay. Thank you for your time today.
Yeah, great. Thanks. Look forward to hearing your discussion. Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay, our next delegation is Glenn Corolla. And Glenn is joining us in person. Good morning. Good morning. So, Glenn, you have up to 10 minutes. Okay. Was this? All submissions have to be received prior to meeting. We'll get it there.
Sorry.
So, when you get down there, we can move, you know, we can move to put this on the agenda if that's where you're headed today.
It's just for visual
Thank
purposes.
You.
Yeah.
Thank you.
It's my own drawing, too.
Is it?
Yes, the little circles.
Superimposed
it's,
on.
It's my artwork.
Yeah. Okay, go ahead. You have 10 minutes.
Okay, so I could start now?
You can.
Thank you. My name is Glenn Corolluck, and I'm the executive director of the Manitoba Eco Network. I'm here today as a citizen, and not on behalf of my organization at this point in time. We too have, you know, just found out about the timing of this strategic plan. So our organization hasn't had a chance to deliberate it on it ourselves, but probably, you know, maybe we will attend the EPC meeting or a council in the future. We can talk about this. So these are just some of the things I know of, and I've talked to people from my work, so obviously I have some knowledge of this, hopefully. And the one thing that I want to speak on with the strategic plan is the item number 34, which is initiate replacement of the Arlington Bridge. Mm-hmm. And one of the outcomes that is noted is that improving connectivity. So improving connectivity is really important, and there are other ways of improving connectivity. And one of the research recommendations that my organization has come up with recently with our Healthy Environment, Healthy Neighborhood project was rail relocation. And a very timely discussion item, and it's been in a discussion works for almost two generations at least. So that is an option that we should look at, and that would sort of suggest that maybe the wording of replacing the Arlington Bridge, in the next 4 years doesn't make any sense.
You can just swap those two out.
Yes. So I mean, my understanding is, when this was reviewed about 8 years ago, the cost at that time was $300 million. The cost may be now maybe $500 million. So everyone's here to save money. So it's a great thing to do. Got an idea for you. So I want to make that statement. And I also want to bring in an idea, which I'm currently doing a bit more research on. So you see that map that I have handed out. It's a map of our inner city, and it's three contiguous areas that are sort of interconnected. The CP yards, the Point Douglas, South Point Douglas, North Point Douglas, and sort of the Seine River corridor. Now, there's a lot of different activities happening in those three areas. We're trying to do a secondary plan for South Point Douglas, perhaps North Point Douglas. There's lots of room for revitalization and redevelopment. There's also, you may know, there's been talks about an urban national park. And there's been a couple of areas that people have been talking about. One of them is sort of the Point Douglas Seine River area, kind of maybe an extension of the Forks. So that's a federal project that we're currently having closed door meetings about. And then, of course, we had the recent train derailments, out by McPhillips. So we have that whole area. And the research that my organization has done was looking at contaminated sites. And there are numerous contaminated sites in these three areas and lots of room to do work on that issue. So there is something, if you go on the other side of the map, a piece of legislation called the Impact Assessment Act. It's a new piece of legislation. The federal government changed its impact assessment regime in the last three years. And one component of impact assessment that they've brought into in a more rigorous fashion is regional impact assessment. And you could see, why we want to do regional impact assessments. There's studies conducted in areas of existing projects or anticipated development to inform planning and management of cumulative effects and inform project impact assessments. So this, to me, would be a win-win-win situation if we could define a broad region within our city where there's lots of ideas for new developments and fixing sort of the problems that exist, and to do a huge community study led by the federal government with lots of money, of course, and the other levels of government, including our First Nations government. So this is a great opportunity to investigate. And that is basically my presentation.
So couldn't agree more with you on all the points. Are there any questions, Councillor Gilray?
No, just I guess maybe just one. Just in terms of the length of time, like we know that the Arlington Bridge, it could go at any time now, like really. So And rail was meant as much as I'm fully in favor of that could be very time unconsuming, should be many, many, many years.
Sure.
So would you rather support not having the bridge open at all? Or would you like the city to maybe look at options where it would allow for pedestrian and cycling if we were going to look at relocation while the bridge is, if we have the ability to do that? The cars weren't going to go on it, but we may have the ability to keep it as still a, some sort of transportation.
Right.
Just because that is a critical area for people to have access, and that includes many pedestrians. And it's a big barrier in terms of the North End. So just your thoughts.
Yeah, I won't speak on behalf of my organization, but that connectivity is really important. So, I mean, what you're saying makes a lot of sense. I mean, I guess what we don't want to do is invest a whole lot of money to build something brand new where we could, you know, look intensely at the other options of maybe perhaps rail relocation. So yeah, fixing the bridge, making it last longer as long as possible. I'm not an engineer, but converting that into like other non-car forms of transportation, that makes a whole lot of sense to me.
What's your next steps? You mentioned all the things that, you know, maybe folks aren't aware of, that there's been a lot of discussion with respect to National Park, a lot of discussion about how the rail yards provide, and as chair of property and development, not this committee, but, you know, the other standing policy committee provides, could provide once remediated, housing, but also, you know, an openness to the city. You mentioned the National Park meetings, and certainly I'm a proponent of a National Park being there, opening up the Alexander Docks all the way to the Forks, but also, you know, the centerpiece. So what are your next steps? You mentioned you might be ready to present at Executive Policy Committee.
Yeah, so what are my next steps? So I have to have more discussion with my organization, which we're doing this week. I've put calls out to the different community members to sort of start pitching the idea. The next steps is to move very fast. And the immediate concern is just the strategic plan. I mean, that's like, you know, change the wording on that. But the more medium next steps is to get community buy-in. And that's just to talk more about this and getting the three levels of governments to agree to it. There is two regional impact assessments that have been initiated across Canada. None of those are in an urban setting. There's nothing in the law that says it cannot be in an urban setting. So we have a regional impact assessment starting up in the Ring of Fire in northwestern Ontario, and one that happened off the coast of Newfoundland looking at the oil and gas industry. So. Talking to an impact assessment expert, that person said, yeah, there's no reason why the federal government couldn't entertain this. It would involve more community talking and it's sort of like a campaign to say, a writing campaign to the federal government saying, this would be good. And the province and the city would also have to agree. It because this isn't on all federal land, the other levels of government have to sign on as a partner to it. At least one of them, I'm thinking, but I mean, it makes sense that all three sign on to it.
Thanks very much for your time today. I appreciate you coming.
Thanks.
Very important.
Okay, our next allegation is Jeff Corlock. Lucas Stewart, also to be heard with respect to the same report. Are you Lucas?
Pardon me?
Are you Lucas?
No, I'm sorry, I misheard.
Okay.
Hi.
Good
morning, everyone.
Good morning. Welcome.
This is my colleague, Clayton.
Hi, Clayton. How are you?
I'm good. This morning, we come to you from the ranch in Winnipeg. For the last 12 years, we have processed thousands of bicycles, rejuvenating them and converting them to their highest and best use case. We've done so under a very good and positive working relationship with the city of Winnipeg. Leveraging both charitable donations outside of our partnership with Winnipeg, having deep and very good community connection for the distribution of bicycles as best we can, getting them to folks who are needing them the most. We've done this over the last 12 years, and have really proven that we have the experience and the expertise to be able to sort through the tremendous amount of material that is coming through the 4R system, as well as the general public direct donations. It's our sense that there is efficiencies to be had, as well as that the act of diverting bicycles from the waste stream is proven now, and it shouldn't be something that is just done on a charitable basis and that or on a granting basis. The funding system leads to a lot less stability in how we can plan. As well, we are ready to move forward and expand to be able to deliver programming across the city in a more meaningful way. I think our recommendation is, as part of the strategic plan, that the bicycle waste stream diversion be moved to a procurement arrangement, and that it can be combined with another high level, high interest item that is bicycle theft mitigation. Organizations like the Wrench are well positioned to be communicating with community about best practices, about how to reduce bike theft, and that's inclusive of education, as well as ensuring that a registration happens so that bicycles can be returned. How to lock your bike up properly, how to encourage how to get bikes back to people. Sorry. being able to couch the services of bicycle waste diversion is, and the being able to do that in a way that is sustainable and predictable as a service that is valuable to the city, couching that in terms of a procurement contract may be a very good use case, very good test case for the city's sustainable procurement policy strategy that is incoming, and we would be up for participating and being a very good first use case for that strategy. Having said that, if that is a ways away, we will be open to just negotiating with the city directly on something like that.
Thank you. Is that your presentation? I have a question.
Do you have anything to add?
Yeah, well, basically, you know, the Wrench has been around for about 14 years, and we have a citywide mandate, and we are expanding. We just opened our third location. But like, we're running into limited inputs. Like, we actually can't get enough of the city's bicycle garbage. So we're hoping to, you know, seeing this strategic priorities action plan, there's, you know, a bunch of key themes, and like waste diversion of bicycles hits pretty much everything, you know, down, you know, providing services downtown and healthy and green communities. And there's also social procurement priority or sustainable procurement priority in this plan. So we're hoping that we can flag this if it's even possible to add that wording in to explore bicycle waste and theft mitigation through social procurement as perhaps the first test case, especially where, you know, we're it's a small procurement, you know, when we're talking about social procurement and thinking of like the North End water treatment plant, like that's a massive project. And there's probably some like social procurement framework that can be applied to that, but it would be a great test case to go through with like for a much smaller procurement exercise with a long-standing city partner.
So I'm not sure if I understand how this kind of relates to our overall strategic plan. However, if we're not diverting our bikes, like you say, that is a concern. We do mattress recycling with Mother Earth.
Yes.
So through water and waste, this could be something we could be reviewing in terms of that, because I wasn't even aware that we weren't doing that. So I'd be happy to talk to you guys further, maybe offline, to see how we can. I sit on the Water and Waste Committee, so just to see how we can maybe work collaboratively together on this in a different manner. Maybe get started even sooner. So So anyways, that's just what I. A comment I wanted to make, because I didn't even know about that, and that's something that I think is important to me. I was part of getting the mattress recycling, up.
And that's been very successful.
It's been very successful.
Yeah.
So we can do the same thing here with our bikes, and we have a good organization that can do that work. I'd be happy to maybe take that one. Very nice.
I have nothing further, but I think Councillor Gilroy, that's a good pathway. I'm not sure. I agree that, you know, this is strategic planning fodder, but I appreciate this is an open door for you to make the pitch. You feel free to use my email at any point. You don't necessarily have to come to Community Committee, Standing Policy Committee, but no door is the wrong door, I suppose. So, I'd encourage you to follow up with Councillor Gilroy in an email.
Yeah, it was really, short notice for us to try to, you know, we didn't quite have enough time to see if there was an ability to like specifically on that sustainable procurement line in the strategic action plan, if it could be flagged for like first test of the system with a local organization on bicycle waste.
I don't think I'm gonna detract from council's priority on social procurement with respect to water and waste. I really don't. I don't agree. But I appreciate that this you're saying this is low hanging fruit. Use this as a test case. That's a nice open door. I think we've gotcha. And definitely Councillor Gilroy and I have met with the social procurement folks down the street. We'll continue to do so. I think you've been involved in those meetings. So if you haven't, I encourage you to talk to Michael Barkman. We're committed to meeting with folks in the social procurement sector and have some identifiable work towards that end, and can provide you an update if you'd like, but more to the point, take you up on your offer.
Thank you for your time.
Thanks
a lot.
Okay.
Our next delegation is Jeff Marlock. We heard Secretary Report Number 23, Plan Approval at 990 Taylor.
Good morning.
Good morning.
You're situated in and amongst strategic planning conversations. Welcome.
Thank you. My name is Jeff Harlock. I'm with Precon Builders here.
Sorry, Jeff.
Representing, pardon me?
Can you just move a little bit to your left so that the mic can pick up your comments?
Okay.
There, that's
is that better?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm Jeff Harlock with Precon Builders here representing our plan approval application for 990 Taylor. We were a last minute addition. I think you would have all of our application stuff. I don't really have anything else to say.
Okay. Thank you. You can be quick then.
That's great.
You have 10 minutes though, so you don't have
to. That's fine. When is the actual, when will we be heard on that? Are we at the very end or?
Are you familiar with the agenda today?
No.
Item 23.
23, yeah. Okay. Which will be a while then.
Okay. I can chat with you after the break, but now is your time to appear in delegation. If you have any comments you'd like to make on your application, you can absolutely make those. Once the committee's done with delegations, they'll move into the reports prior to the public hearings. So it'll probably be dealt with within the hour.
Okay.
Okay.
That's fine. Thank you. I have no further comments.
Okay. Okay. That's very good.
Okay, so the next delegation is Shirley Forsyth to be heard via or on report number 21, and Shirley is joining us via Zoom. Shirley, you have up to 10 minutes if you want to go ahead and unmute yourself and turn on your video.
Unmute, start video. Good morning. Good morning. I'm going to share my screen because I can never remember what I was going to say. Just okay. So I enlarge that. Oh, and now I have to forget how to share the screen at the same time. Sorry.
That's okay. Take your time, Shirley. Okay. How are you
share
this
screen. Click. There. Share.
Oh, there we go.
Good morning. Good morning, everybody. I'm speaking today as Shirley Forsyth, a resident of Winnipeg and a member of the Associated Regulators Symantec Active Travel Network, and I'm really sorry, but there wasn't a lot of time to prepare this. So the SPAP document, I believe, could be improved by recommending amendment to subsection 2473 of the City of Winnipeg Charter to include criteria to protect the environment and the well-being of communities and residents. On page 12 of the states, council doesn't have to implement any proposal on our Winnipeg 2045, but any action taken must be consistent with the City of Winnipeg Act. The SPAP will have the same difficulty as our Winnipeg in achieving better health and protection of the environment, as there are always competing interests and no way of mediating or prioritizing outcomes. The City of Winnipeg has criteria to follow for decision-making, but only in specific circumstances, such as for a variance. This criteria is set out in legislation. And this is not working. Sorry. Okay, I'm going to have to try to get this out of here. And I'll just keep talking. Oh, I don't know. Strategic priorities. Get bigger. Can you see this?
Yeah, we can now. It's sort of sharing in a kind of a quarter of the screen way. If you just want to use it to refer to your notes.
Okay. Sorry about that.
And then I'd like to see you. There we go.
Okay, got me. All right. Okay. So I'll keep going over here. So I'm talking about the charter and there should be a test that references the potential for an injurious effect on the community due to a variety of reasons, including the environment, the loss of trees and green space, shade problems, and increased traffic and our air pollution. It's not. To an action to work with the province, we need to work with them to modify subsection 247. 3 of the City of Winnipeg Charter, so it's in line with other jurisdictions in Canada and contains a reference to the environment, neighborhood livability. I have 7 points. The second point, urban design guidelines need to be changed to ensure the space available for trees is included as part of a setback. A theme of the SPAP is to strive to build a city that is safe and improves the health and well-being of all residents by making high-quality services more available, accessible, and affordable. Sounds good, but history foretells this will not happen. It is known that low-income areas have fewer trees and parks, but most trees are not being planted in Winnipeg's low-income areas or mature communities. The city needs to support developments with landscape setbacks, which are informed by guidelines that require the space necessary to plant canopy trees. Setbacks that allow for the planting of canopy trees are becoming more common in other major urban areas as cities struggle to increase their tree canopy in order to mitigate the effects of climate change on their communities and the health of their residents. The following 2 illustrations were taken from award-winning Canadian Urban Development Guidelines, which emphasize the importance of trees. Winnipeg demonstrates its lack of commitment to an urban forest by using a definition of an active front without referencing the necessary area for setbacks that will support the planting of canopy trees and amenity spaces for multi-unit buildings. I have an illustration here. I hope you can see it. It shows what we're doing right now. Building form, then plus enhanced landscape buffer. That equals a green approach. The green approach is referenced in the strategy, but doesn't talk about how to get there. There's a second figure that again shows the setbacks necessary to achieve more trees and green space. My third point, in order to achieve SPAP priorities, Winnipeg needs green space targets, and it needs to track targets by community area. 4, in order to achieve a more equitable distribution of green space, Winnipeg needs to adopt practices that will increase green space as part of its planning process, such as the use of pedestrian views, short pedestrian-only laneways having a minimum width of 6 meters, or work with the province to update guidelines for exterior amenity spaces for multi-unit buildings, and then include these, as other jurisdictions have done, on the green space maps as park areas. The city should prohibit the sale of city property in communities where there's a demonstrated need for park space. Winnipeg has 4.2 hectares of parkland for 1,000 people. There should be no sale of city property without evidence to show that the community has sufficient green space before it can be considered surplus to the city's needs. A recent example of where city property was sold in Osmond Village, despite an obvious need for park space, Osmond Biz has only 0.4 hectares of park space for 13,000 residents. This is far short of the green space needed to provide a healthy community for residents. There's a quick figure here showing you where the parks are located, how large they are, the poverty mark, and the Osmond Biz area. The property was sold against community process and city policy. The chair of the Parks Committee released a report that stated low-income areas will be a priority for park space in Winnipeg. This statement of policy was not acknowledged when city councillors approved the sale of 145 Osborne Street as surplus. The property was listed as surplus in an area where the deficit green space significantly below the Winnipeg average, and it was located in a densely populated low-income area. This is a closer up of the map showing where the lot was. There's dark teal there showing that it was a high concentrated area of poverty, and the red lines a higher poverty neighborhood. 5, the city needs to release the ratio of public green space per 1,000 people by community as one of the SPAP indicators. 6, there needs to be a budget line for reviewing community plans every 5 years so that the city knows about where it is and how it's achieving its goals. And 7, health and active travel should be part of SPAP. A sustainable green approach to growth and renewable infrastructure needs to focus on biodiversity, which is not mentioned in the strategy, climate resiliency, renewable energy, waste diversion, protecting and growing the urban forest, road and pedestrian safety, and public and active transportation. It's impossible to discuss the health of a community and its residents without talking about the importance of an active transportation network that will support active travel within and between communities. The SPAP does not consider active travel within communities, but focuses on cycling networks on collector and arterial streets. The city needs to release its pedestrian and cycling strategy, and it needs to contain secure bike parking, greenways, pedestrian mews, or cycling routes which support cycling and active living for all ages and abilities. I think I'm going to stop here and just thank you very much for listening to my presentation. I hope you were able to see it.
Thank you. We did see it, you know, very briefly. If you want to send it to your favorite counselor, I'll read it in further detail. Are there any questions for Ms. Forth at this time? Okay. Thanks so much for your presentation. Really appreciate that you're engaged in the strategic planning piece, and I've taken note of your charter amendments. We'll need an active government on Broadway to be resettled before they can contemplate legislation, but I did take note of that today. Thanks very much for your time. We'll move on to the next delegation. Councillor Gilroy has a question.
Just before you do, just noting the time, we have to start a public hearing, so we might have to take a pause. And
you're absolutely right. So our public hearing process for the committee starts at 10:30 typically. So we'll move into.
Yeah, so just that was our last registered delegation. So if we want to just open the public hearings, we can take a brief break from them and deal with the regular agenda and then go back to public hearing, or we can get right into public hearing and deal with the regular agenda items after the public hearing items.
Okay.
So we'll go to public hearings.
Or I think you're saying you wanted to go open the public hearings, take a break, deal with the regular agenda.
That's right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. Okay, so for the public hearing portion of the meeting, in accordance with the City of Winnipeg Charter and the Development Procedures Bylaw, the committee will follow is the applicant will be heard first, followed by those in support of the application. Next, those registered in opposition are heard, followed by those registered for information. Finally, the applicant may return to speak and rebuttal the comments made. However, no new information is permitted. Please note that when your name is called, it is your opportunity to speak. However, you are not obligated to do so. For more in-depth overview of the public hearing process and other information pertaining to what happens before, during, and after a public hearing, please consult the City Clerk's Department website. Please note that all public hearings are recorded and will be part of the public record. Should you have any questions after the hearings have concluded, please contact the City Clerk's Department. So prior to moving into hearing number one, we're just going to take a brief recess from the public hearings and we'll deal with the regular agenda items, correct?
Yeah. So first up on our regular agenda items is a semi-annual summary of delegated authority to award per capita land dedication and community incentive grants. And this is a hotly awaited item in mine and other councillors' offices because it took some time to get this together, I think, this year. Do we have a mover?
Yes, someone.
All right, that was carried unanimously. We'll move into occasional liquor permits, Manitoba Craft Council.
So moved.
Thank you, that was moved unanimously. Same thing, but for Pride Winnipeg Festival.
And so moved again.
That was moved unanimously. Same thing, Wildwood Community Center.
Happy to move.
And that was moved unanimously. The next item is a PCG for Al Weeb. He's doing a homelessness. So if you'd like to move.
Yeah, 500, please.
That's moved unanimously. Same, Jerry La Forteza.
500, please.
All right, that was moved unanimously. Per capita grant, Jordy Craddock.
And that's for the block party, right?
Yep.
Yeah, okay. That's 250.
All right. So moved by Councillor Gilroy, moved unanimously. PCG West Broadway Community Organization, full amount.
Well, Mount, happy to move on your behalf.
All right, that was moved unanimously. The convalescence home of Winnipeg. Councillor Gilroy moves.
Happy to move.
Move unanimously. Oakenwald Parent Advisory Council. Councillor Gilroy moves. That was moved unanimously. École La Vérendrye School Parent Council. Councillor Gilroy moves. That was moved unanimously. Earl Grey Neighborhood Safety Association. Councillor Gilroy moves. That was moved unanimously. Churchill High School. Councillor Gilroy moves. That was moved unanimously. College Churchill High School. Microphone portion. That was moved unanimously. Linda Menes School Parent Advisory Committee. Councillor Gilroy.
So moved.
That was moved unanimously. Sikh Heritage Manitoba. Councillor Gilroy.
$100 from my per capita.
That was moved unanimously. Community incentive grant, Crescent Fort Rouge. Councillor Gilroy.
On your behalf, happy to move.
That, sorry, Councillor Gilroy is going to need to move opposition to.
Oh, sorry. So this community incentive grant program is no longer in effect.
Oh, right, yes.
So this was laid over a couple of times, and that's the only reason it's on the agenda.
Okay. We'll need to receive it as information. I will then move it into the LDR component that we just moved, I thought. Or do we need to do that next meeting?
Yeah, we can chat.
Okay, we'll chat about that. Okay, move as information. Yeah. That was received unanimously. Land dedication reserve, called Crane Grounds, it would be the same thing, right?
Nope. To the clerk? The LDR fund is still in effect.
Okay, there we go. Sorry, LDR, wrong fund. Okay, that was moved by Councillor Gilroy.
Yep, so moved.
That was moved unanimously. Honorary street name, designating Yonge Street between Cumberland Avenue and Notre Dame Avenue as Portugal Way.
Happy to move this.
That was moved unanimously. Then we move into extension of time subdivision rezoning. Councillor Gilroy.
So moved.
That was moved unanimously. Strat priorities action plan. Councillor Gilroy.
So
I'll make some comments here too.
For sure. We heard from many different delegations today. And as everyone is aware of the strat plan, we actually went away and did a strat plan for the city, and it was trying to collaborate on everything we'd like to see in the strat plan. And it's interesting listening to the delegates here today. My plan is to receive this as information, and I know that there's dialogue to allow this to go forward to EPC, but asking at EPC that it gets laid over so that we can still come together as a council like we have been doing and really look at what came through our different committees in terms of delegations and see and do a little bit more work before approving our strat plan. So that's my intentions right now. And so happy to move this to receive this as information.
There are recommendations on the agenda.
Okay.
If you wanted to concur with the public service.
Yes.
Yes. Yeah. Okay. That's your thing.
Yeah.
Yeah. So if we can, if are you, Councillor Gilroy, if you, I think it'd be important to identify for the record to some of the recommendations that the public service is asking for. Okay. I can do that if you're finished.
Sure. You want to go ahead?
Yeah. Okay. So reiterate, we did begin this process and put it on the agenda last term. So for folks that are coming and saying, you know, this is a tight timeline, I at once agree and don't agree. Because it was identified as work that we were going to engage in, perhaps following the election, that was a surprise that we were doing what we said we were going to do. But certainly a lot of this shapes up previous years at council. It is being referred to the budget process for financial review and consideration in the 2024-2027 four-year multi-year balance budget. And for my part as councillor for Fort Rouge East Fort Garry, I have 5 days identified in June. Once council is going to continue with the strategic planning, but I have, a 3-day piece and a 2-day piece to get to budget process and to provide Fort Rouge East Fort Garry and indeed Folks from across the city, though there will be a limited number of seats for other folks, an opportunity to strategize with me as we move into the budget process. This is one of the recommendations here, that the Strategic Priorities Action Plan be referred to budget. There is also time to refine the priorities. I'm as a downtown councillor, I'm more than pleased with some of the priorities as a Fort Rouge Youth Work Area. This is a lot of what I ran on, including a strong downtown, a strong economy, a livable, safe, healthy, happy city that is more straightforward on social service investments, a green and growing city and sustainable renewal of infrastructure that is absolutely needed. In order to grow in a city that works for residents through improved customer service. So I'm content with those themes. Do they need to be refining? Well, we saw presentations today that are very close to my heart, including the National Park discussion. Arlington Bridge here sneaks in here. I do think it's easier to contemplate essentially the revitalization of our entire city, the lands that are needed for development, if we open up those rail yards. And it takes some strategic planning to do just that, because it's not a simple process. And it's nice to see someone who has the knowledge of impact assessments, as I did prior to getting here, when I worked for Mineral Resources for a number of years. I think it's an interesting presentation, and I'd gladly swap it out. Today isn't going to be the day for that. I'm going to receive it as information, but and pass these recommendations. The third recommendation is the public service work with council to report back in September with a framework to measure and report on the Strategic Priorities Action Plan. So for those of you that are worried that today is going to be it, you see right in the recommendations that we pass that is going, number one, up through council this month, but that it's landing back in council in September. And I think that's important to note too. If you're feeling pressed for time, if you're feeling like, you know, this is one and done, it certainly is not. There is an iterative process planned, but we need to be one of the major cities in Canada that aligns a four-year strat plan with a four-year, you know, multi-year balanced budget. Different councillors will go about that planning process differently with respect to strategic planning with their own ward. It starts today with community committee though, it's an important milestone, and I'm very pleased that Laura is here, because you and Jonathan have been stewarding this process up and through council and now to the public. Big day today. We don't oftentimes celebrate milestones, especially transparent ones like this, that this council has strategic priorities. We know that pertaining to the environment and pertaining to a happy, healthy city, we've got our work to do. That's where you can see the most conflicts arising at council. I want to be transparent about that today too. I do expect, that to be the meatier portions of this, these themes. So with that, I'll turn it back to Councillor Gilray for the motions.
For sure. And then I just want to say on the record that Laura is here, I just do want to thank the administration. This is a very tough process. As you can imagine, getting this all into a room and trying to get us to agree on a strat plan is not an easy task. And they're in the room for some very, very tough discussions that take place during that time. So I just want to thank them, because it's not hard. It's a very easy, hard job, I think, to hurdle all of us in trying to get us to really collaborate and try to come together on certain items. So I wanted to thank the public administration. So on that, so moved.
All right, that was carried unanimously.
Item number 22. So Madam Chair, this is a issue that is really relevant in my community. The administration has leased out a tennis courts that are in my area that are, that is for community use. However, the community really deals like they're not getting access to it. And of course, they're asking for more tennis courts in the area. And I've got a population in my community that just absolutely loves tennis. So therefore, I am asking that when this lease comes up, that the city no longer leases this out. This is a business-run opportunity for this person. I'd like it to be community use and free for the community. As part of our poverty reduction strategy, we're always looking at ways we can provide community this free time to play and use our facilities and make sure that they have access to that. So I'd like to keep that open and access to the community. So that's what my motion is for today.
Okay. And this motion then heads to Protecting Community Services. Sorry, Community Services.
Yes.
All right. All those in favor, that's
aye.
Moved by Councillor Gilroy and passed unanimously.
And before we get into anything else, can we have a bio break?
Can we do one more?
Sure. Motion? Oh, we have one more.
So we still have the two addendum items.
Yeah.
Okay, that's
and
right.
And then a new business.
A new business.
Yes.
Motion.
So yeah. So okay. So
we expanded the rules for these two, right?
Yep.
So allowing so this
just
is,
concur with public service recommendation for the plan.
I concur with the public. With the administration and the plan approval for 990 Taylor.
Okay. Thank you very much. That was carried unanimously. Again for Lord Roberts School.
So moved.
That was carried unanimously.
And then there's one new business item that's not on the agenda.
Do you want me to put this forward or do you want me to take
it?
Yeah. Okay. We have a motion here. Do you want me to do this? Oh, you updated it? Thanks.
Yeah.
I'm gonna just okay. Sorry. Whereas council's top priority is a strong downtown, whereas Winnipeg are being consulted with respect to the needed investment at Portage and Main. Therefore, be it resolved that the Standing Policy Committee on Public Works be requested to direct the public service to explore opportunities for improvement, multimodal access at grade crossing at Portage and Main.
Excellent, Councillor Gilroy. Any discussion?
No.
Then that too passes unanimously. We'll move on.
A short break before we get back.
Yes, please. Actually, we're just going to take a 2-minute health break and then we'll move on. Sorry, you were out of the room and we kept going.
I missed my opportunity.
I think we can come back to you at the end.
None of these are yours, right?
Oh, yeah. Number one's mine.
It's mine.
Number two's mine.
Number
three. Here we go.
Yep.
All right. We'll start back into the hearings.
Can I take the chair for this?
We're live. Just so you know.
No.
No. We're good.
Okay.
You'll know where I'm going. Okay. So we'll start back with the first subdivision and rezoning for 90 Wellington Crescent. This was a matter, I understand, it was laid over till today. So we'll start with a presentation from the public service.
I'll just introduce the item. And
yeah,
item one is a subdivision and rezoning at 90 Wellington Crescent, 586 and 588 River Avenue under file DASED 57 of 2022. In accordance with the City of Winnipeg Charter and the Development Procedures Bylaw, this is a combined hearing and the following item will also be heard at the same time. Namely, item two, which is a variance at 90 Wellington Crescent, 586 and 588 River Avenue under file DAV 228750 of 2022D. Please note the communications were received with respect to the matter, which have been distributed to all members of the committee. The process the committee will follow is the applicant will be heard first, followed by those in support of the application, those registered in opposition, and those registered for information. Finally, the applicant may return to speak and rebuttal the comments made. However, no new information is permitted. All participants joining via Zoom have been muted and will only be permitted to speak when called upon. If any participants are currently watching the live meeting on YouTube, please mute your audio player now. And I'll just pass it over to planning for an overview.
Good morning, committee. The site is located on the southwest corner of two arterial streets, Wellington Crescent and River Avenue. It's composed of 90 Wellington Crescent, 588 River Avenue, and 586 River Avenue, which is across the public lane to the east. The site is in the McMillan neighborhood of the Fort Rouge's Fort Garry Ward. The property is located within a mature community under the Complete Communities Direction Strategy 2.0 and falls within the boundaries of the Osborne Village Neighborhood Plan. The property is currently zoned R2, is 18,000 square feet in size, and currently contains a fourplex and two vacant single-family dwellings. The immediate area is characterized primarily by multifamily residential development. The Osborne Village Commercial Strip is approximately a five-minute walk east of this property. The applicant seeks a rezoning to the RMFL zoning district and variances for lot area density, yards, and parking in order to build a four-story 51-unit residential development composed of two buildings on subject property. A third-floor walkway will span the rear public lane connecting the two buildings. 20 units in the development are proposed to provide supported housing for those living with mental health issues. The development will contain an on-site kitchen to serve the needs of those living in the supported housing. The development also is planned to contain affordable units through a partnership with CMHC. The development will include 33 parking stalls, mostly underground, as well as a car share vehicle and indoor bike parking. The applicant worked with the Urban Planning Division to make adjustments to the design of the proposal. Specifically, the applicant agreed to provide individual entrances facing streets on the ground level in order to provide a welcoming, pedestrian-friendly appearance from the street, underground parking so that active uses could be provided on the ground floor, visually interesting street-facing facades using different materials, wall plane recesses and projections, windows, doors, balconies, and transparent windows to promote safety and provide interplay at the sidewalk. Indoor bikes parking at a minimum ratio of 0.5 lockup per unit. Finally, an arborist report was provided and the applicant was asked to do community consultation. None of the existing buildings are listed. However, because two of them can be seen to be heritage contributing properties under the Osborne plan, the applicant was asked to submit engineering reports detailing the building's condition in order to justify whether the removal is required. NSK Northern Engineering conducted a building inspection report for the two in question, that's 586 and 588 River. They concluded that both buildings present, this is a quote, a safety and health concern are beyond a repair limit and should be demolished as soon as possible to eliminate the potential of injury to people and or damage to surrounding structures. In addition, in 2022, the building at 586 River was hit by a bus. The applicant indicates they held an information event at 6:30 p.m. on February 2nd, 2023. The Urban Planning Division recommends approval of the subdivision rezoning and the variances because in alignment with our Winnipeg 2045, the proposal aligns with the goal of developing a continuum of affordable and supportive housing. The proposal meets Complete Communities 2.0 vision for established neighborhoods to continue to evolve as complete communities to increase the diversity of housing choices, improve housing affordability, and more efficiently use land, infrastructure, and services. And the proposal meets the Osborne Village Plan. The variances reflect what has been traditionally supported in this urban mature community context of Osborne Village. That's the intro from Public Service.
Okay, are there any questions at this juncture?
No.
Okay, I have one. You include the traffic piece, i.e. the accident that happens on this corner. It's a pretty tight corner. It's also one of those magical places in Winnipeg where there is no line demarcation on the street. So you're driving downriver, you're turning on Wellington, and boom, magical lane changes. There seems to be a few lanes driving up. There seems to be a different type of lane going down. Talk to me about the orientation of the building, the sidewalk space, and what has been accounted for here when you're looking at, how the building relates to what is an everyday pinch point for Winnipeggers that traverse River and Wellington.
The applicant was asked early on to connect with the Public Works Department about that very intersection where River turns into and becomes Wellington Crescent. That's the corner where this one of these buildings is situated, to ensure that the The alignment of the building will match future proposed change in alignment there, because their Public Works is planning a renewal of River and Wellington starting this summer, and a slight change to the turning radius at that corner. So the applicant did do that and did receive feedback from Public Works, and then designed the building in order to align with the curve. And my understanding was that Public Works saw that as working with their plans for the street change. Being located on this corner, there is good access because both streets are arterial routes. The access is good. And in addition, this summer, traffic protected bike lane is going to be installed between June and October. On River turning the same corner, and then on to Wellington, and then on to Stradbrook, which will add another source of access for people of using cycling as their mode of transportation, and will also create some traffic calming on the corner by slightly narrowing some other aspects of the street.
Perfect. Thank you very much. We'll move on.
Okay, we have the applicant with us here today, Matthew Chambers. You want to come up and speak? You have up to 10 minutes.
Yeah, my client is actually going to go first. Okay. This is his application.
So. Jeff Mills.
Mr. Mills.
Good morning. Give me a moment.
Just make sure to click share screen on the laptop so
okay.
That everyone on the stream can see it.
It's working.
It's working. Okay. Just 1 second.
Sorry. One more thing. Oh, okay. Sorry about that. I want to zoom. Sorry about that.
Oh, it's okay.
There you go. Thank you. Hey, good morning, everyone. Thank you so much for having us out here this morning to speak about River Avenue and 90 Wellington. My name is Jeff Mills. I'm from PRE Developments, and I am the builder of this project. Just to give you some site context, bit of an overview here. The site is located in the mature area of Osborne Village. Three structures would be demolished as part of this application. Mr. Ross already spoke about the condition of at least two of them. The other one is not in great condition, but it is currently being lived in. 586 and 588 River Avenue are structurally unsafe and are currently vacant, as mentioned. And that one structure was hit by a city bus earlier last year too. The current zoning is R2. The proposed zoning we're looking for today would be RMFL. To give us some further site context, the north of us is River Avenue. The south of us is a multifamily R2 zoning. The east is also multifamily R2 zoning, and the west is Wellington Crescent. Our proposal is for 51 units, 33 parking stalls for a 0.64 parking ratio, 36 bike stalls, a car share program as well, dedicated stall for Peg City Car Co-op. 20 units at minimum would be supportive housing through our partnership with Cambridge Health. This proposal does align with our Winnipeg 2045 goals, meets the policies of the Osborne Village Neighborhood Plan, and also meets Complete Communities 2.0, the vision of established neighborhoods. We did work in lockstep with the public service on this application. There's a nice rendering of the building from the corner of River going on to Wellington. We certainly did collaborate with Public Works on that corner. Councillor Rowlands, you mentioned the need for that corner to be appropriate to its significance in Winnipeg. We also share that vision. That's why we decided to curve the building to provide that proper visibility as you turn onto Wellington Crescent from the one way on River Avenue. We also wanted to dress up the facade with high quality materials like limestone and a curtain wall of glass and aluminum. We really feel that that is a very prominent corner, and we wanted to make sure that it got the visibility it deserves. Also within the structure, we are going to include a fitness center and two multi-purpose rooms on the top floor with outdoor patios. There's another view of the building from the River Avenue side heading towards Wellington Crescent. Recognize that car is actually going the wrong way now, but just envision going the other way. Yeah. And then that's the opposite side on Wellington Crescent, looking at the facade once again. The application's, in our view, fairly straightforward. However, there was a request by the public service for a 6-foot widening on the back lane, the side lane. We're not specifically opposed to that because we recognize the need to improve the width of these back lanes for the services, garbage, recycling, pickup. I guess the only thing that I would share with the community committee this morning is the 6-foot widening does cause a bit of concern with our plan. As you can see, the red line does cut right through our building. So with that 6-foot lane widening being specifically on the west side, we do lose 3 units and we also lose 7 parking stalls as a result of that. And we have tried over the last few weeks to try to redesign the building to make it all work. And sadly, we're unable to do that. What I'm proposing to the committee as possibly a compromise would be 3-foot widening on the west side and 3-foot widening on the east side. I recognize that it doesn't get the community the entire lane widening on that one end, but it does provide a proper approach to River Avenue, which I think is the main concern, so cars and service vehicles can get in and out. Just to further my point, there's a couple of pictures here just demonstrating what that might look like. Again, the 6-foot widening on the entire west side would be a loss of 3 units for us and 7 parking stalls. The 3-foot widening on either side would be a much better end result for us and potentially a good compromise for the community. I did take a picture here off of Google Maps, at least, of the 6-foot widening a little farther down the lane. And as you can see, the 6-foot widening really just cuts into the parking that's already there on an angle. So I'm not sure that the lane widening will ever actually happen the entire length of the lane. So to impose the lane widening on us at this juncture would be pretty injurious, and it would be hard, again, down the road to really widen the entire lane. Whereas if you did 3 and 3, potentially, homeowners on both sides would be more agreeable to that. And then you could in fact widen the entire lane in the end. A few concluding remarks about our proposal. Once again, it does remove 2 structurally compromised and vacant structures. These structures have been vacant for almost 6 years, so it is time to do something with them. In our opinion, it provides an excellent facade on a prominent city corner. Again, we're using very high quality materials. The proposed buildings and density are consistent with nearby developments. And again, we worked very closely with the public service to ensure that we fit within the plan. The developer is using high quality building materials that embody the character of the neighborhood. Again, tindal stone and aluminum and glass curtain walls. We feel that the project achieves many social housing goals. Again, collaborating with Cambridge Health for supportive housing for people with mental health issues, as well as affordable housing through the CMHC Affordable Housing Program. We feel this is a great opportunity to provide housing for people of all demographics in a neighborhood that really is truly quite remarkable in Winnipeg, because you can essentially walk anywhere and do anything, which is quite awesome. And lastly, the project aligns with city objectives and provides needed backlane space to provide better access and service. Again, we're open to options. We're working collaboratively with everyone here, and we just hope that we can land on a good compromise with respect to the backlane. And with that, that's my presentation. Thank you so much.
Any questions at this juncture? Okay. I have no further questions, although I will make a comment. With respect to the lane, I am the counselor, and so I know that there's already garbage concerns sometimes with respect to pickup.
Yep.
So just a comment, you can respond if you'd like.
I understand. We've built in Osborne Village four other times, and I get the challenge, you know, having bins aligned a proper way, recycling bins everywhere. I understand the need for the lane widening. We're not opposed to it, and I appreciate you need to have a better approach. All I was saying was just, I think that the lane widening for the entire length is going to be hard to do. And I'm just hoping for a compromise where we could split the difference, and that way it enables us to build a little better on the west side. But no, totally, I'll totally get the need for the lane widening and better access to services. Okay, thank you.
Okay, our next speaker is Hao Chang. If you don't, sorry, I should comment. Yeah. You don't have to come up to speak if you don't
want
to.
I'm just going to answer anybody have a concern about our program and coverage health. That's if there's no concerns, I don't need to speak. I will support it.
We have 10 minutes and up to folks if they want to present. It's really up to you. It's a public hearing process, so up to you. Okay, we'll move on.
The next person we have in support is Matthew Chambers. Did you want to speak?
I just want to speak on the application.
Is there anyone else here in support of the application whose name hasn't been called and wishes to speak? Seeing none, we'll move into opposition, and we have Shirley Forsyth joining us via Zoom. Shirley, if you want to go ahead and unmute yourself and turn on your camera, you have up to 10 minutes for your presentation.
Good morning. I'm really hoping that sharing the screen will work this time. I'm sharing the screen now. Share. There we go.
We see it. Go ahead.
Wonderful. It's work. Okay, good morning, everyone. I'm here as a resident of the area. And of course, as everyone knows who lives there, these homes are from the exterior, gorgeous looking homes with a very long history in the community. AFM's River House and Christie House in 1966, 57 years ago, Alcoholics Foundation of Manitoba established the first women's in-house addiction facility in Canada, located at 588 River Avenue. It's not been a single family home for, well, as you can see, 60 years. River Home was a 15-bed women's in-house treatment center. In 1971, 52 years ago, Christie House, a new community base, opened at 586 River. Women, up until the new facility was built, were frequently seen in the area, sitting on the lawn, smoking, enjoying each other's company, and these were really two landmark homes. The Arbus report shows 17 trees of reasonable structure on this property, small trees and shrubbery not included. Three large mature oaks are approximately 150 years of age each. None of these trees are going to be retained with this development. None. It's a huge loss. I was contacted by a long-term Osborne business person last week about the loss of trees in this area. That's actually the first time a business person has reached out about the loss of trees to me. Due to variances, it does not appear that any of the mature trees will be saved. The lost trees will not be replaced by any canopy. This is the Arbus report. It shows where the trees are located. The big oaks are along here. They're just a short distance from the footprint of the building, which should not have happened. Biodiversity. The native fir oak supports more than 500 species of moth and butterfly larvae, while non-native or newer varieties of trees may support or host zero species. A key theme of the strategic plan is a growing city, which is a green approach that supports sustainable infrastructure, which protects and grows the urban forest. This development does not meet these priorities. It is red development as opposed to green. This proposed development goes against the Arbus report and preserves none of the large canopy trees. They will be replaced by skinny column trees that may house zero moths or butterfly larvae or other insects. This development should not go ahead as is, and the planner should not have supported a building that will be toxic to the community and not support shade trees or trees native to the area that support biodiversity. Osmond Berlin Behringer's, the new tradition of illuminating green space for new development. This submission states it has become traditional within the last 12 years in this neighborhood for developments to express an urban pedestrian-oriented built form to the use of reduced setbacks. These reduced setbacks were achieved against public input. Reduced setbacks are not conductive to a green approach in regards to mitigating climate change are retaining Winnipeg's urban forest, despite this building replacing two elegant Tudor-style buildings that mark the entrance to Osmond Village. The Urban Planning Division supports variances that reduce green space, prevent the planting of canopy trees, and do not provide green space that is associated with mental health. Okay, and here's a quick diagram showing what it should like. Right now, we're doing building form. That's the elements of green approach. Then to have a green approach, which is in the strategy, there's enhanced landscape buffer equals green approach. We don't have that here. We have the red approach. We've got a large building with no landscape buffer. These is a map. And this is certainly not to scale, but I quickly draw on the number of community meetings I've been to within the last 12 years, showing the number of buildings that have came down, and they've all had these reduced setbacks so that there can be no canopy trees put back into this community. Variances, traffic, canopy trees, heat and air pollution. Variance requested in this application will decrease the distance between busy streets and residents. These setbacks, if approved, will prohibit the planting of canopy trees that help absorb CO2 and pollutants. It is estimated that 52% of all small particle pollution from road transport comes from tire and brake wear. In the most modern cars, almost 2,000 times more particle pollution can be produced by tire wear than is pumped out by their exhaust. There are long-term effects associated with fine particle matter to the environment and health. It is essential that the setbacks allow for at least one row of canopy trees and that the tree canopies touch be effective. These variances do not take climate change, biodiversity, or the health of the residents into consideration. The proposed balcony projection is 5 feet along River Avenue, bringing the balconies close to the property line. Balcony projections at or near property lines have an adverse effect on mental health due to constant traffic noise and respiratory health due to micropollutants. Winnipeg's Urban Planning Division is ignoring the literature when it states there are no adverse health effects to buildings being close to the road and eliminating green space through the use of reduced setbacks that prevent the planting of canopy trees. A red approach, we need the green approach. These variances should be denied for the health of the community and the environment. This is just an illustration of variances, canopy trees, and the Osmond Village developments. This development, if approved in its current form, will mean the loss of the canopy trees, and there will be no exterior green amenity spaces, which the previous residents made constant use of. Tree count for River Osborne. This shows that Osmond Village is fairly rapidly losing trees. But in particular, if you look at River, which is here in the circle, there's been no trees planted, nor will they be able to plant any canopy trees because there's not going to be room. Temperatures in Osmond Village, 2017. The red star marks River Avenue. And as you can see, it's becoming more red. It's high temperatures in July. There's around the current buildings we're discussing is green because there's a fair number of trees. With this development, we can expect it to move to the red. Higher temperatures for the people living there. Again, this is red development, not green development. Now I just have some pictures to show changes in the canopy. 2012, just not that long ago, the big house had been taken down. We had a kind of using as a parking lot, and we still had a lot of trees along the river. And you could actually see the sun when you walk down the river on the way to work in the morning. 2015. Buildings are starting to come out. We still have a fair number of trees. 2020, more buildings, reduced setbacks. When you walk around the corner in the morning, which I used to do every day, you no longer see the sun. It's you're walking in darkness and there are trees are rapidly disappearing. This big gray square shows all the trees and how when if this building is allowed to go in with reduced setbacks, the greenery that we will be losing. I'm just asking to be no more reduced setbacks. And basically, I'm going to stop here. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Any questions for Ms. Forsyth at this time? Appreciate the time it took for the presentation and the PowerPoint that we absolutely did see. I'm confirming that. thank you for your time today. Do appreciate the time and effort you put into the delegations this morning, as always.
Thank you.
Moving on.
Okay. We have no one else registered to speak in opposition. Is there anyone whose name hasn't been called who wishes to speak in opposition to this application? Seeing none, we have no one else registered for information. Same question on information. Anyone wish to speak? Seeing none, if there are any questions for the public service, we should deal with those now prior to having the applicant back for rebuttal.
Okay. Question for the public service. The loss of units are hard to hear for a counselor like myself that likes density. But parking stalls, if I can quote some song lyrics, give it away, give it away, give it away now. I don't care. So with respect to the public service recommendations, I'm amenable, but with respect to the 6 feet as a local counselor, I appreciate the care and attention it takes for the public service to make sure that the garbage is being done. Are there any, anything else that you think I should consider? Because I want to move this, without revealing too much at this juncture, I'm inclined to move it along. Is there anything I can do to delegate to you?
Yeah, I guess one thing I could add is it, it seems straightforward to widen the lane, but it actually would create some complications in this case if I could go over what those would be. So, first of all, the garbage on the lane, and my colleague Kevin can speak to this more, but my understanding is that Public Works didn't mention the garbage. They mentioned that widening is requested as a standard request for infill developments. This particular development will not have any garbage receptacles on the lane because they're housed in the building. And it'll be rolled out on collection day, taken back in. The other thing to think about is if they do, the developer is required to trim back their building, even the 3 feet. Yes, they would lose some units, and that would be okay in terms of the public posting of the variances because it would be a lesser density variance than what was posted. However, for the parking stalls to have less, they would lose some parking stalls, and we can't approve less parking stalls than was posted publicly on the poster because that's a greater variance than was posted publicly and is being considered here at the public hearing. So for that reason, if there is any widening to the lane, the applicant would need to come back for a new parking variance. One of the other challenges I would like to point out is that the underground parking garage has its own minimum dimensions for the length of stalls. There's two rows of stalls. Each row needs to have length of 20 feet and the drive aisle needs to have a minimum length of 20 feet as well. That's 60 feet. And the ramp has to have a maximum grade down. So you need a certain amount of length to go from the lane down to the bottom of the parking garage with space at the end for the cars to turn properly while meeting the building code. So a lot of things will start to get pinched. those are some of the things that would change as a result of lane widening. I'm happy to take any other questions if you have.
So what I don't like is that we get to a public hearing and I then feel weird about whether or not this will in fact get built. Right?
Yeah.
Because this is, I don't want to see, you know, this corner not being activated, right? So, you know, as a jumping off point, I'm looking at you at the table to tell me about that risk.
Taking the land on the west side was on the east side was investigated due to the hydro poles right on the lane. It's not feasible. Basically, the standard that Public Works is looking for is single family density in a greenfield site for the width of the lane. Right. So if this was a greenfield site, this is the standard they would be looking for to service single family, not multifamily. So they are compromising on the width they are asking for. It is to reduce conflicts with refuge trucks. And anything is better than nothing, essentially. Yeah, it's just the rim.
So talk to me about that in terms of 3 feet versus 6 feet.
3 feet will allow a pavement width of, I believe, 4.5 meters, which is still better than what's currently there. It's 4.5 right-of-way, or 4.5 width open right-of-way. So you do get some increase width, but it's the wider you go, the more less complex you have, right? The easier it is for the trucks to maneuver, the more encroachment you can tolerate.
Yeah, I already have problems here. So, if you were to do the analysis on this, you're not, in the risk assessment, you would be, if you needed to talk to this with respect to a paragraph, how would that read?
I would need to get back to you. I'm not sure if there's a risk assessment that's done other than it's below their normal standard.
But not at 6 feet. Okay. All right. We'll leave it there.
So we can have
anyone want to respond?
Sure, we can have the applicant back to speak in rebuttal to any comments made. So Jeff, if you want to come back up, you have up to 10 minutes.
Can I just have also the senior planner comment too?
Sure.
Mr. Ross?
Yep.
Sure, Councillor. Just to add, just looking at facts only, there was the most recent other development on a river, which is just east of this property,
yes,
by a couple blocks, went up without a lane widening. So it's the same width as this one. It's got a new multifamily development on both. I think it's both sides. I need to take a look, but one at least that went in without the lane widening. I just wanted to add that to the conversation.
The DAZ in 2019 would only a DAZ, in which case you cannot take land.
So can you say that a little louder?
The application for DAZ 202 of 2019 was a DAZ, which is not a subdivision rezone, not a subdivision. So you can't have a lane widening on a DAZ. Hence the lack of a request.
Say that last part again. I didn't hear you.
It was only a rezoning, not a subdivision.
And so fill it out in plain language.
The type of application that they submitted.
This is a subdivision and rezoning.
This is a subdivision
and rezoning.
And therefore normal rules are that you would, or normal requests are that you would have the lane brought up to the standard. Whereas a DAZ doesn't allow it, afford that opportunity.
So we took an opportunity here
we have an opportunity here. We did not have an opportunity at 2019.
Okay. Anything further from the team of public servants?
So just so I'm kind of clear, so it's going to be less units if they have to.
Three less units.
Yeah.
With the public service recommendation and some parking losses. Okay. That's all the questions I have, unless folks are still contemplating and want an intervention in the public service. If not, we'll move.
I'm sorry, I missed that.
If there's nothing further here,
okay.
In terms of contemplation, okay, move along.
Okay, thanks. Thank you very much for considering our request on the lane widening. Again, giving up that land does cause us a lot of problems with our design. There is only so much land. Excuse me, only so much land available there to build on and provide housing and parking. And, you know, as Mr. Ross mentioned, our garbage recycling is underground. It's not going to be outside. So we're not looking to add to the problem. But in a perfect world, we would seek approval today for the application we have on the table rather than trying to contemplate this back lane issue. Again, I really do feel that although I love the idea of widening the back lanes just from a practical standpoint, I just don't know if it's realistic that if we're going to have the lane widened the entire length, as I mentioned in the presentation, just from all the, you know, other parking requirements down the lane and other things in the way, it's just probably not going to happen. So to put that on us now with our application is going to be pretty hard for us to move forward if that happens. But I mean, we can try. I just wanted to talk about the loss of the trees. And there are arbor support. There's a number of trees mentioned. There's actually 13 in the south side yard that actually are getting retained. So we actually are only losing the four that are right in the middle of the building structure. But the other 13 that are along the south side yard are being retained as part of this application. So they're not in the building footprint. However, if we do have to redesign the building as a result of the lane widening, the ramp may have to be orientated 90 degrees, which would mean we'd have to lose some of the trees in that south side yard. So that would be the only comment I could make on that. But I mean, we are doing what we can to retain trees. I mean, we are, you know, we do like trees. It's just, unfortunately, the land is only so large. I think that's all I really had to share here.
Okay, I have no further questions for you, but thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so that concludes the press portion.
So I'll give you the chair.
Okay.
So I move that the report of the Winnipeg Public Service be taken as read.
All in favor?
Aye. I move that the receipt of public representations be concluded.
Carried.
I move that the recommendation of the Winnipeg Public Service be concurred in and forwarded to the Standing Policy Committee on Property and Development.
Motion is carried.
And I want to move the following supportive reasons, namely, I recognize this was moved over to this hearing, and I want to thank all the players for their patience with that respect. I believe that this has been designed in alignment with the Osborne Village plan, but moreover, the plans for Osborne Village in the future, which does include, an emphasis within Osborne Village, which I know are a priority for the residents, that in some important way, climate justice equals housing justice. So I want to acknowledge those component pieces that are very thoughtful, including the affordable housing letter of intent and the Cambridge Health letter of intent that are included with this package. But I also want to comment particularly on the beauty of the design. The limestone and the curtain wall is not lost on me as a place-taking feature of Osborne Village. As you turn the corner, I want to acknowledge the beauty and the intentional design here in celebrating this building. Now, I'd like to see this building done, but I can only contemplate on what's before me. I'd like to see this building built. And the exchange between public service and planning has to be better, as well as the local counselor. I do have garbage pickup woes in Osborne Village. So the time and attention for public works to contemplate that and the length of widening, i.e. when the garbage trucks literally can't get through the back lane, they actually don't. They don't pick up garbage. And so I need a better discussion with public works and planning, because I need to do complete communities as I'm adding density. So I welcome further discussions on that, because it is difficult to hear that after a lot of discussion, a lot of public hearings, and a lot of postings, we're so insecure about the loss of three buildings and parking that, frankly, I would forego. But, you know, I can contemplate what's here before me. I see a public service that's done a lot of work with the applicant to get us where we are. And I see a building that I think a lot of folks will celebrate on a very beautiful corner. And to that end, I'm very grateful for the work that has taken place to date. I encourage parties to continue talking and hopefully expedite this project. But for the following supportive reasons, I'm excited to move it on again and signal that renewal and change that is commensurate with the public works that is happening on River, the bike lane, and the thoughtful widening, something that, you know, as we've been proving at community committee work in River and Osborne, we've been really cognizant of. So I know that work will follow, those investments will follow, and I'm grateful for the applicant's beautiful design here and thoughtful project. So moved.
All in favor, it's carried.
And I move that the public hearing with respect to this application be concluded.
And it's carried.
All right.
Okay, please note the committee has made a recommendation on this matter that will now proceed to council. No further representations are permitted on the subdivision and rezoning. All persons registered for the public hearing will receive notice when the matter is to be considered by council.
All right, with respect to the variance, I'm prepared to move with Councillor Gilroy still in the chair. I move that report of the Winnipeg Public Service be taken as read.
Carried.
I move that the receipt of public representations be concluded.
Carried.
I move that in accordance with subsection 2473 of the City of Winnipeg Charter, the variance is consistent with Plan Winnipeg and any applicable secondary plan does not create a substantial adverse effect on the amenities, use, safety, convenience, and of the adjoining property and adjacent area, including an area separated from the property by street or waterway, is the minimum modification of a zoning bylaw required to relieve the injurious effects of zoning bylaw on the applicant's property and is compatible with the area in which the property to be affected is situated. In terms of supporting comments, I will put all of my supporting comments on the record from previous motions. So moved.
Okay, motion is carried.
I move that the recommendation of the Winnipeg Public Service be concurred in and the variances be approved.
And motion is carried.
I move that public hearing with respect to this application be concluded.
Carried.
Please note that the committee's decision with respect to this application may be appealed. Should you wish to appeal, information on how to do so will be included in the order issued, which will be mailed to all persons registered.
Back to you, Madam Chair.
All right.
Okay.
Introduce the next item.
Item number three is a zoning agreement amendment at 75 Waterbury Drive under file ZAA2 of 2023. Please note that the communication was received with respect to the matter, which has been distributed to members of the committee. The process the committee will follow is the applicant will be heard first, followed by those in support, those in opposition, and those registered for information. The applicant may return to speak and rebuttal to comments made. However, no new information is permitted. And I will pass it over to planning for an overview of the application.
Sure. Thank you, Kate. So 75 Waterbury Drive is located on the west side of Waterbury Drive in the Linden Woods neighborhood of the River Heights Fort Garry Ward. The subject property is approximately 17,800 square feet in area and contains a single family dwelling and a detached garage taking access from Waterbury Drive. The property backs onto a stormwater retention pond. The site falls within the established neighborhood recent communities policy area under the Complete Communities Direction Strategy 2.0, and the subject site is zoned R1L, which is residential single family large. The applicant is proposing to amend the existing zoning agreement on the property's title for the purpose of constructing a one-story addition to the rear of their existing dwelling. The proposed dwelling addition would be 72 feet from the rear lot line abutting the retention pond rather than 85 feet required under the zoning agreement. Therefore, a zoning agreement amendment application is required. So the public service is supportive of the proposed amendment because it has been reviewed by the Water and Waste Department, who did not have any concerns with the proposed rear yard. The Winnipeg zoning bylaw was amended in 2014 to address setback requirements for all lots abutting stormwater retention ponds. It now states that the Director of Water and Waste may reduce any one or more of the minimum yard requirements if they conclude that the safety of people and property would not be unduly compromised by the reduction. However, any existing zoning agreements would proceed until such time that they're amended or removed from the property's title, notwithstanding this new section in the zoning bylaw. Additionally, the proposal is generally consistent with complete communities, and there are no anticipated adverse land use impacts as a result of the reduction. So for these reasons, we're supportive of the proposed amendment, and I'd be happy to answer any questions.
They didn't require any, like, I guess they're far enough from their neighbors to require any of the neighbors' signatures on this? I know in my area, because we're so close together, I'm in our city, so we're going to do an extension or whatever to get the signature from the neighbor beside.
They didn't submit any signatures from the neighbors. The property is about 18,000 square feet in lot area, the side yards are pretty substantial.
Yeah. Okay.
We'll carry on.
Yeah.
Okay. The applicant, Michelle Heckel, isn't registered to speak to the committee today. We don't see her in the audience, but she did submit her comments in writing. And we have Luke Dick here to speak in support of the application.
Do you have any questions on your board?
Okay.
Okay, you have 10 minutes on the record. It's up to you whether you present. We don't, it's not iterative. You won't ever know if we have questions, but what you know, if you want to present, come here. If not, you're good.
Yeah.
All right, move on.
Okay, we have no one else registered to speak in support of the application. Just to confirm, is there anyone whose name hasn't been called and wishes to speak? Seeing none. There is no one registered in opposition to speak and no one registered for information. And just to confirm, for no one in the audience to speak on this application in opposition or for information? Seeing none.
You want to catch the chair? I'm ready if you want.
I can do it if you want.
Okay, go ahead.
I move that the Winnipeg Public Service, the report of the Winnipeg Public Service be taken as read.
That was carried unanimously.
That the receipt of representations be concluded.
Carried unanimously.
That recommendations of the Winnipeg Public Service be concurred in and forwarded on to Executive Policy Committee via the priority rezoning process.
That was carried unanimously.
And for the following supportive reasons are, it goes with complete communities. Looks like a great project. Yeah. And there was no conditions put on by Water and Waste.
That was very good, honestly.
Okay. And that the public hearing with respect to this application be concluded.
That was carried, honestly.
Okay, please note that the committee has made a recommendation on this matter that will now proceed to council. No further representations are permitted, and all persons registered for the public hearing will receive notice when the matter is to be considered by council. Moving on, item number 4 is a rezoning at 751 McMillan Avenue under file BAZ 200 of 2023. In accordance with the City of Winnipeg Charter and the Development Procedures Bylaw, this is a combined hearing, and the following item will also be heard at the same time, namely item 5, which is a variance at 751 McMillan Avenue under file DAV 111550 of 2023D. Please note the communications were received with respect to the matter, which will be distributed to all members of the committee. The process the committee will follow is the applicant will be heard first, followed by those registered in opposition and those registered for information. The applicant may return to speak in rebuttal of comments made. However, no new information is permitted. And I'll pass it over to planning to give an overview of the application.
Thank you, Kate. The subject property is located on the north side of McMillan Avenue in the McMillan neighborhood of the Fort Rouge East Fort Garry Ward. The subject site is 6,006 square feet in area and is currently occupied by a 2.5 story house built in 1910. Under the Complete Communities Direction Strategy 2.0, the site is within the established neighborhoods, mature communities policy area. The site is also located within the medium density residential policy area of the Corydon Osborne Area Secondary Plan and within the medium density residential area policy of the Corydon Osborne Plan Development Overlay. The applicant proposes to rezone the property from the R1S PDO1 Corden Osborne Residential Single Family District to the RMFS PDO1 Corden Osborne Residential Multifamily Small District in order to construct a 4-unit multifamily building that is 2 stories in height. There's an associated variance application to reduce the minimum lot area, front yard setback, parking stall off of a lane, and to permit no buffering of the parking area from the rear lot line. Development in the Corden Osborne area plan is subject to a mandatory urban design review at time of application, of which the proposal has satisfied the requirements of the urban design review. We are recommending approval of the rezoning as well as associated variances, as the proposal is consistent with the policies guiding development in established neighborhoods, mature communities, and the Complete Communities Direction Strategy 2.0. Also meets the locational criteria for a fourplex within the Corden Osborne secondary plan and is within the allowable density allowable for multifamily found within the Corden Osborne PDO. It also meets all the standards and design guidelines found within the same with the above secondary plan and PDO. That concludes my overview, and I'm happy to answer any questions.
Thank you. Any questions on the structure? All right, we'll move on.
Okay, I don't actually have the applicant registered to speak. Is there anyone in the audience who is the applicant?
Yeah.
Derek Koo?
Yep. Yeah.
Okay. Want to come, you have up to 10 minutes for your presentation.
No, just going to be quick. I'm excited about this redevelopment. Refreshing this lot, the building is reaching the end of its useful life. The only note I did submit, I have been working with the neighbor to the east with the two-family home. I did with my pre-application and application submit a letter of support from the owner of that building. It's been great working with the public service just to make sure that I'm including all those design elements and matching the character of the neighborhood. And we're excited to get this project started. That's it for me. I can see if there's questions or I can.
I don't have any further. Thanks.
Okay, is there anyone else here in support of the application who wishes to speak? Seeing no one, I'll move on to opposition. First up, we have Pat Ilasiewicz. Pat, if you want to come down, you have up to 2 minutes to speak.
On the side, yeah. There you go. Yeah.
I think it's on the back.
Oh, is it not?
Oh, you're good. Yeah.
And then just make sure you press share screen in the Zoom meeting. And then just the icon at the bottom there, the Zoom icon before you make it full screen. Yeah, just click that and then there. And then hover down a little bit and it'll have a green button, share screen. That's what you want to pick, yeah.
Okay, perfect.
Perfect.
He's using Teams, sorry.
Okay.
Well, thanks for having me. My name is Pat Ilasiewicz. I'm a resident who lives down at 745 McMillan. I've lived out in Calgary for quite a few years, and I was able to marry a Alberta girl, as they say. One of the requirements for us to move to Winnipeg for a job promotion for me was to move into a neighborhood with a character home, and something like a McMillan was very desirable. When we did buy our house in 2008, it was actually quite an effort to buy one of these houses, as they kind of go pretty quick. I would like to state that we are up for redevelopment. However, we feel that it should respect the character of the neighborhood and it should leave a positive impact on the neighborhood. My main reason for the opposition to the rezoning proposed is the front setback is quite small, and really it should be increased to fit in with the neighborhood, not reduced. It really doesn't match with anything else on the block or to the block to the west. Secondary reasons would also be a lack of parking. There's an increase of impervious area due to the larger building footprint, as well as the paved parking area and concrete curb along the building. There's no room for snow and or garbage for that matter, and there's going to be a loss of mature trees. I'd like to point out too that we are a destination neighborhood, especially on weekends. You sit on our front porch and you can watch all the people coming in. They're going to Tom Bergen's, they're buying a coffee, they're walking through the neighborhood, they're looking at the houses, they're chatting with the residents. It's a very interactive community, and we hope to continue that continues in the future. We know it is kind of part of the Osborne development plan, and the little red dot there is the lot in question. As you can see on our section of the neighborhood, we don't have a lot of R1 lots left. They're slowly disappearing, but density in general, it's not something we really, I don't think, is an issue, because we do have a lot of apartment blocks and multifamily units already. Concerns with the setback are, most of the stuff on the block is over 30 feet, and that's front to front of porch. Kind of what they're proposing for the unit, although they're showing it's 23 feet to front of building, they also have a enclosed balcony on front, which sticks out another five and a half feet, depending on which drawing you look at. So that setback is really going to be 17 and a half feet from front of property to that front of that structure. The apartment block to the west, that has a setback of 26 feet 6 inches, so that's like another 10 feet. That's going to be a pretty big standout. Here's kind of just an image of the neighborhood itself. That blue line right in front of the building, that's the 23 feet, and then the second blue line, that's 18 feet from property. So you can see in the entire block, there's nothing that sticks out this far. And one of the reasons we're also concerned about this is there are two additional properties on the block which have been bought, turned into rental houses. They slowly get run down, and then they also will be up for, I guess, rezoning in the future. So doing something like this is going to set a precedent for the entire block that is really going to change the look and feel of the neighborhood. Here's a good just image of what the actual size of the unit is going to be look like compared to the R1 unit that's currently there. If you look on the side where that apartment block is to the west, it's even bigger than that, and they're putting in 4 units in that proposed building. Just as a kind of visual, the pylon there I measured, that's roughly 18 feet from property line, so you can see that's going to be the front where the actual balconies are going to stick out. It's going to stick out way further anything to the west, and from the east, front of these porches is 30 feet, so everything's going to be 12 feet out from here as well. So it's really going to be an eyesore in our opinion. This is a view on a development that's happening just one block west, actually probably was 4 houses down. As you can see, they're matching the front of the adjacent buildings. Even the height is consistent with those. And their front step also matches kind of the front step. So it actually fits in with what's there. With this unit, there are concerns about lack of parking. We already have 2-hour restricted parking on the street. Lots of people come down to our neighborhood and frequent it. One concern is just, you know, when you have your elderly parents over, there's not really anywhere to park. So this is going to make the situation a little worse. There are 4 units proposed. They have 3 queen or bigger beds, and assuming 2 people per bedroom, that's a possibility of 24 people at this residence. They are proposing 3 permanent spots, one visitor, and one handicap. So that means there's potentially a lot of parking on the road. Another issue behind this property is a, three-story apartment block. And whenever we get any sort of winter storm, snow drifts over this. So if you get 6 inches of snow in Winnipeg, we get a foot in this back lane. And we really have an issue with garbage collection as well as where to pile the snow. Currently, what the residents do on that property is they push it against the apartment block on the other side. That then makes it so the garbage cans are inaccessible and the bins aren't picked up for sometimes a month or more in the winter because they just can't get access to it. Currently, there are three large, metal bins in that location. And then there's a whole bunch of blue bins scattered over the apartment blocks. One other concern is we seem to have a issue with a lot of ponding water in our neighborhood. Right now, anytime it rains, especially in the front on McMillan, you're going through a large puddle all the time. A lot of time it's curb to curb and overflowing. You go down to the Assiniboine River, unfortunately, after a large storm, and you can see a lot of debris from raw sewage, which has been overflowed because we're on a combined sewer system, which ends up in the river. Something like this is going to further increase that impervious area. And I know they talk about disconnecting the house from the sewer system, the combined sewer system, and putting in a sump pump. But what we find happens is, and this picture on the right is the apartment across the street, is they put in a sump pump. And then they pump it to the asphalt parking lot, which in this case ran over the sidewalk directly into the combined sewer. When we complained a bit about that, then they put in this pipe. Now it runs down the parking lot into the back lane and into the combined sewer on the other road. Also a little bit concerned, we're losing trees in our neighborhood left and right, unfortunately, a lot due to Dutch elm disease. And this property, it looks like they're not the prettiest, but they are mature trees. It looks like there's going to be at least 10 trees removed, and then they're going to be replaced with some small shrubs and maybe a couple lilacs. I'm not sure exactly what's proposed. We do have a lot of migrating birds that come through the neighborhood, squirrels, rabbits. This morning, as a kind of omen, I thought it was, we actually had three baby deer in our front yard. So there is a lot of wildlife around, but this does use this kind of these trees as habitat. In the end, I just want to say we're up for redevelopment. However, we just think it should respect the neighborhood a little bit more. I don't really see how this building fits in and adds positively to our neighborhood. And that's what I have to say.
Great. Thank you very much for coming. Are there any questions? I have no questions. I think you're thank you for the time and effort you put into your presentation.
Okay. Our next speaker was Timothy Ducree, but he's not able to join us in person today. So next up, we have Shirley Forsyth joining us via Zoom. Shirley, if you want to go ahead and unmute yourself and turn on your video, you have up to 10 minutes.
Hi, everyone. I don't have a presentation. I ran out of time.
Okay.
Really heavy agenda. So I came today because I was out for a walk. I was attracted by the trees and the green space in front of the home and the garden. And I spoke with the people living there now. And I made a commitment to them that I would attend this meeting. Because, of course, they're very upset about leaving and losing their home. People on the second floor apparently have just came from the Ukraine. It's dramatic to lose their home. It's going to be dramatic to lose another character home. Again, as I've spoken about these sort of red approaches, which means we have variances that don't support. Often, canopy trees, these we get shrubs are column trees. We did successfully in Gertrude protest a flat roof. Which was just a block, well, very close. The community came out and we were able to win that because this building has a flat roof, which is out of keep with all the other houses on the block. So it'd be too bad to have another large square building that was never the intent of the people working on the community plan. We wanted, I was part of that process, we wanted buildings that looked more like the homes that existed with verandas, not balconies. It's not working out. I don't know if we've had a single home built with a balcony since we got our plan. So it's completely not working. So this is going to be a larger home than what we wanted. It's going to take up green space. The back will just be hard space for parking. There will be balconies, which are chosen because if you do a veranda, that counts when it comes to the footprint of the building than if you put on a balcony. So we're ending up with these buildings that are projecting another five feet further than what the community wanted and what was expected when we created the plan. So we're going to lose mature trees. We're going to have another building that never met with community expectation. I know I've come forward many times to say we really need to review the plan to see if we can't overcome these difficulties. And frequently I'm told there is no budget line for reviewing plans, though it is really essential if we're not going to lose our communities, but because we're getting developments that we did not want in the plan and we're rapidly losing our mature trees. And this is a really interesting looking lawn and yard full of all sorts of gardening stuff, and I feel very sorry for the people that we're displacing every time we do one of these developments. And anyway, I'm just here because I made a commitment to the people who live there that I would show up. So thank you.
Thank you very much. I see no questions. We'll move on.
Okay. We also had Jill McLeod registered, but she is not speaking. So is there anyone here today whose name has not been called, who's in opposition to the application, who wishes to speak? Seeing none. Anyone for information? Seeing none.
I don't know if someone is trying to speak, but we're having technical difficulties. Is that the case, or someone's still in with us?
I've muted Shirley, so I'm not sure what that is.
Okay.
If there are questions for the public service, we can deal with those now before hearing back from the applicant.
Rebecca? Any questions for the public service?
Not just yet.
Okay, we'll move on.
Okay, Eric, you have up to 10 minutes to speak to any comments made for your rebuttal. However, no new information is permitted.
Okay. First, I'll apologize, Pat, for not reaching out to you and speaking with you directly, but you can for sure chat after this and discuss anything. Sorry, I'm just going to look at my phone just so I make sure I cover all the points. I guess easiest, the garbage, we do have indicated side garbage on the plans for where all the bins will be located. Currently there it is a little bit of a mess back there with the garbage bins, and so we're trying to bring that back in alignment. I guess parking, we're maintaining what the current parking there is, although we are losing our front driveway access. I think we're one of the few buildings on McMillan that has a front driveway access currently, but that's being brought back into alignment. So it is unfortunate, I guess, with that limited number of spots. Just a little bit on the, combined sewers and the water pumping, this building does not have a basement. So there is no, it's going from a building with a basement to a building that's on grade. So there is no need for sump pump, as well as, based on the provincial guidelines, the development cannot increase the combined sewer, is from my understanding of the combined sewer runoff. And as far as, I guess, with the front balconies, I know I've had some back and forth. That should be more transparent of a balcony or more closed in for privacy. I'm open to either option, what ends up coming of it, but that is something, is. And just with the last presenter, just with the tenants, I do have families from Ukraine that moved into the second floor recently. They were informed of this development happening when they moved in, that this is a shorter term lease for this reason. As well as the flat roof, there's another, I guess my pre-application did have a hip roof design. And I guess it came to light through the water waste that the building needs to be non-combustible. Doing that with a wood framed hip roof is not, I guess, wouldn't meet that requirement. And so that's where we transitioned to the flat roof so that we could build it out of non-combustible materials and do a concrete roof that way. I don't know if there's any questions or comments on that?
I see none. Thank you. Okay. We'll move on.
You're the chair, Councillor Gilroy?
She can be.
Okay. If
she'd like.
Sure.
Yeah. All right. I'm going to move that the report of the Winnipeg Public Service be taken as read.
Carried.
I'm going to move that the receipt of public representations be concluded.
Carried.
I move that the recommendation of the Winnipeg Public Service be concurred in and forwarded to the Executive Policy Committee via the priority rezoning process.
Carried.
Standing Policy Committee on Property and Development. Sorry.
So carried.
I move the following supportive reasons. Literally was just down there a couple of days ago, walking around with my husband. I do believe in no particular order here that, and I want to put, you know, these 3-4 points in the record, that there is a better utilization of infrastructure, including water and wastewater, with respect to the combined sewer district that it is in. And I want to forward that. That's a very important point to me. The increase of housing options, it will go to no surprise to this committee, is including aging in place and options for multifamily is a priority for me as a counselor. I'm supportive of the pedestrian activity, including the balconies and the front, the front piece. And I want to indicate that mid-block, I would be more contemplative of the setbacks here. At the corner, and as you round the corner to McMillan, I do believe you're going to get the interactions with the pedestrian that is really the priority for the neighborhood. And that, you know, the balconies that are practically at grade actually do better than the decades and decades old building that is just next door to it, at relating to the McMillan Arbuthnot block here. In terms of design and in terms of pedestrian activity and the welcoming neighborhood that is the McMillan Lilac neighborhood, avoiding those blank walls which are present just next door is something that I like to see with respect to design in this neighborhood. In addition to allowing folks to contemplate moving from their 3-story home, for instance, their large 2-story home, and being able to age in place or downsize within the neighborhood, those are priorities for me. So with those comments, so moved.
Motion is carried.
I move that the public hearing with respect to this application be concluded, and I'll move on to the variance.
Motion is carried.
All right.
Please note that the committee has made a recommendation on this matter that will now proceed to council. No further representations are permitted on the rezoning. All persons registered for the public hearing will receive notice when the matter is to be considered by council.
Okay. I move that the report of the Winnipeg Public Service be taken as read.
All in favor?
Motion is carried. I move that the receipt of the public representations be concluded.
Motion is carried.
And I move that in accordance with subsection 2473, the City of Winnipeg Charter, the variance is consistent with Plan Winnipeg and any applicable secondary plans. It's not create a adverse effect on the amenities, use, safety, and convenience of the adjoining property and adjacent area, including an area separated from the property by street or waterway, is the minimum modification of zoning bylaw required to relieve the injurious effects of zoning bylaw on the applicant's property and is compatible with the area in which the property to be affected is situated. And with respect to supporting comments, I'll just move what I already moved on the record with respect to utilizing the strategic infrastructure, water and waste, and combined in a combined sewage area, increasing housing options, the supporting pedestrian activity, including the avoiding of blank walls, which can indeed be incompatible with the area. In this case, there's been some thought to the design elements to support pedestrian and neighborhood activity. So moved.
Motion's carried.
That the recommendation of the Winnipeg Public Service be concurred in and the variances be approved.
Carried.
Move that the public hearing with respect to this application, with thanks to the neighbors who came in support of the McMillan area, always an active area. Appreciate that very much. And that this application and hearing be concluded.
Motion's carried. Back to you, Madam Chair.
All right. Please note that the committee's decision with respect to this application may be appealed. Should you wish to appeal, information on how to do so will be included in the order issued, which will be mailed to all persons registered. All right. Item number 6 is a rezoning at 638 Jubilee Avenue under file DAZ 226 of 2022. In accordance with the City of Winnipeg Charter and the Development Procedures Bylaw, this is a combined hearing and the following item will also be heard at the same time. Namely, item 7, which is a variance at 638 Jubilee Avenue under file DAV 209262 of 2022D. Please note that the communications were received with respect to the matter, which have been distributed to all members of the committee. The process the committee will follow is the applicant will be heard first, followed by those in support, those in opposition, and those information. The applicant may return to speak and rebuttal the comments made. However, no new information is permitted. And I will pass it over to planning for an overview.
Thank you. So the subject property, 638 Jubilee, is located on the south side of Jubilee Avenue in the Lord Roberts neighborhood of the Fort Rouge, East Fort Garry Ward. The site is designated established neighborhood mature community under the Complete Communities Direction Strategy 2.0, and the property is zoned R1M, residential single family medium. The property is 37 feet wide and 162 feet deep for a total lot area of 5,994 square feet. The property currently contains a single family dwelling and a detached garage taking access from the back lane. So the applicant is proposing to convert this existing dwelling into a two-family dwelling. The current two-story dwelling is clad with stucco and wood siding. It contains front and rear decks, and the existing garage is also proposed to remain on site with additional parking proposed off the lane beside the garage. A rezoning from R1 to R2 is required to permit a two-family dwelling use on this site. Additionally, two variances are required to accommodate the conversion of the existing building. The first being an east side yard of 3.1 feet instead of 3.7 feet, and an east side yard eave projection of 1.8 feet instead of 1 foot. These are both existing conditions of the site, and where appropriate, the public service strongly encourages adaptive reuse and minor intensification of existing buildings. And supporting these minor variances would allow that to happen. So the public service has recommended approval with conditions. We're supportive of the proposed rezoning and variances for the following reasons. The conversion proposes to add one additional dwelling unit on the site for a total of two dwelling units, which is a minor change to the density of the property. The existing dwelling and garage will both be preserved. The subject property meets the preferred location criteria in the infill guidelines for up-down duplexes in that it has sufficient lot area and lot width and has access to a back lane. The proposal adds new landscaping to beautify the site, which is consistent with the landscaping design guidelines in the infill guidelines. And there's nothing to suggest that adding the second dwelling unit in the existing building would have any substantial adverse impacts. We'd be happy to answer any questions.
Okay.
Any questions? We can move on.
Okay.
I think we have the applicant Grant Bossy here with us today. So Grant, if you want to come up, you have up 10 minutes for your presentation.
It'll fit, just give it a shot.
And then just a reminder to click share screen.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Grant Labosser from Architects at Play. As mentioned, I'm here to discuss 638 Jubilee. A bit of a typo on my site plan there. It's 638, not 628. And like as mentioned, it's an existing 2.5-story dwelling. You can see the site plan there. We are adding some landscaping to help beautify the site a bit more. The building is an existing single family dwelling, and we are proposing to make minor modifications to the interior to allow for a two unit development. You can see the existing structure. We don't plan any major modifications to the existing exterior other than some freshening up of the cladding. There are existing decks on the front and back, which I believe are maintaining or redoing. On the interior, there are, again, no major modifications. The first unit will encompass the main floor and basement with the access to the unit at the back of the house. And the second unit will be encompassed in the second floor and the half story above it. And that unit will be accessed from the front. There are again no major modifications to the building other than floor plan revisions, and also there'll be required code upgrades to ensure that the fire separations and sound separations are met as per the code. All the existing windows and cladding again will be maintained or refreshed. And here is just a more detailed site plan from the landscaping designer, just showing the landscaping that is proposed. It's a pretty straightforward project, so I don't want to take up too much of your time, but I just wanted to run through the project quickly just to I'm here if you have any questions.
I have no questions, Councillor Gilroy. Mm-hmm. Appreciate the time. Thank you for your presentation.
Thank you.
Back.
Okay, we have no additional registered speakers in support, in opposition, or for information on the matter. And just the camera, there's no one in the gallery. So if there are no questions for the public service, then there's no opportunity to rebut, and you can move right into motions.
Okay. If you want to catch the chair, sure, I'm ready. I move that the report of the Winnipeg Public Service be taken as read.
All those in favor, carried.
I move that the receipt of public representations be concluded.
All those in favor, carried.
I move that the recommendation of the Winnipeg Public Service be concurred in and forwarded to the Standing Policy Committee on Property and Development.
This can actually go via priority.
Sorry, via priority executive policy committee, via priority rezoning process.
All in favor, carried.
And I move the following supportive reasons. As a local councillor, this is a dream project. There needs to be some revamp of a lot of older homes in the area. And if I could duplicate this project all the way down Jubilee, while I keep an open mind always to what's before me, I also keep a priority to wanting to make sure that there's housing for Winnipeggers and making sure, you know, the best and most environmentally friendly way we can do that is to tackle a project like this. So I can only imagine our planners gleefully adopted this project. I hope it was in terms of the process, because boy, if anything needed to be replicated, and I can feel the seething energy from my colleague, Councillor Gilroy, because she too would want this type of project. So for reasons of climate that we've talked about today on and off with respect to the strategic plan, you know, I'm supportive of the project, and those are my supportive reasons. Let's go.
All in favor, carried.
And I move that the public hearing with respect to this application be concluded.
All in favor, carried.
Seeing as the committee has made a recommendation in this matter that will now proceed to council, and no further representations are permitted on the rezoning. All persons registered for the public hearing will receive notice when the matter is to be considered by council.
With respect to the variances, I remove that the report of the Winnipeg Public Service be taken as read.
All in favor, carried.
I move that the receipt of public representations be concluded.
All in favor, carried.
I move that in accordance with subsection 2473 of the City of Winnipeg Charter, the variance is consistent with Plan Winnipeg, and any applicable secondary plan does not create a substantial adverse effect on the amenities, use, and safety and convenience of the adjoining property and adjacent area, including an area separated from the property by street or waterway, is a minimum of modification of zoning bylaw required to relieve the injurious effect of the zoning bylaw on the applicant's property, and is compatible with the area in which the property to be affected is situated. Supportive comments. Environmental friendly design. Let's go.
All in favor, carried.
I move that the recommendation of the Winnipeg Public Service be concurred in and the variances be approved.
All in favor, carried.
I move that the public hearing with respect to this application be concluded.
All in favor, carried. Back to you.
Please note that the committee's decision with respect to this application may be appealed. Should you wish to appeal, information on how to do so will be included in the order issued, which will be mailed to all persons registered.
All right.
Move to adjourn.
Move to adjourn. Thank you very much. Unless I still don't see Marianne. She didn't come back.
No.
All right.